No mai, haere mai, from our house to your house. Welcome and happy Easter. Welcome to the Streets Easter Service.
Today we remember and we celebrate the most significant story of all time. It's the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ some 2,000 years ago.
The power and the impact of this story and of the message contained in it has affected more lives and continues to affect more lives than any other story, any other message throughout all of time. This Easter story is well worth your personal investigation.
And so in about 15 minutes time, Simon Gill, one of the Streets pastors, will be telling the Easter story. But before that, we're going to join together and we're going to sing and worship God.
It's wonderful to worship together. And the songs that we're going to sing, they tell the story of Jesus. And as we sing them, it's a way of us expressing our minds and expressing our hearts to God. So you may want to sing along. You may want to stand up, sit down. I don't know. Or maybe you just want to listen and sort of observe. That's fine as well. And kids, if you've got your instruments or you'd like to dance, now's the time.
Excellent. So whatever works for you. You know, after Simon's sermon, we're going to be sharing communion together. And actually, we've been preparing a meal for ourselves and for our daughter Hattie and her husband Dave. So we're going to be sharing communion at our dinner table. Now, if you're not yet ready to have communion, maybe now's a chance just to pop away and get that so that you're prepared for the end of the service.
Yeah, that'll be really lovely. We would love to see some photos sent in today of you and your bubble buddies enjoying the online service together. So do take a moment, take a photo of you all and send those in to online@thestreet.org.nz.
Fantastic. So look, before we begin, how about we ask God to bless our time together? Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you that we are here in the name of Jesus. We thank you that wherever we are, you are with us. And so, Holy Spirit, we invite you to come in power to reveal more and more of Jesus to each one of us. Father, we thank you for this time we will spend together. We commit it to you now in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Let's worship together.
Power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, 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 Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter, the King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. that you bear my cross. You lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, oh, oh. Jesus, I sing for that you've done for me.
Kingdom,
Yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is, what a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ my King. What a powerful name it is, nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus.
One of the very best things about having a relationship with God, whose name is beautiful and wonderful and powerful, one of the very best things is that we get to come to Him and pray. We get to come to Him in prayer. And that's what we're going to do right now, all of us together.
So let's pray. Father, we thank You that Your name is wonderful. We thank You that You are powerful and You are beautiful. We thank You, Lord, that You are faithful and You are trustworthy and You are true. We thank You, Father, that You know us and that You know what we're going through even before we go there. Father, we thank You that You hold us secure. You're an anchor to our soul. And Lord, we honor You right now because You are the sovereign God. You are the King of Kings and You are the Prince of Peace. You're the Lord of Lords. You're the wonderful Counselor. We love You. We honor You.
Yes. Mm. And Father, right now we take a moment to lift up to You those people that we know in our worlds who are going through a tough time. And as we think of their names, maybe we see their faces, we raise them up before You. And we ask You, Lord, to supply what they need, to intervene where intervention is necessary. Right now we ask and we pray on their behalf. We intercede for them. And we do this in Your name, Lord Jesus.
And Father, we thank You that not only do You hear our prayers, You hear the prayers of every person on the face of the planet. And Father, we want to commit to You our world, particularly those countries that are really struggling with COVID-19 at this time. We pray for the governments of every nation. We pray, Father, for the provision of medical supplies. We pray, Father, for breakthrough and for help where it is most needed. We thank You, Father, for the advances in our nation. We thank You for our governments, and we continue to lift them up as they lead us. And Father, we ask that above all and through all, that people would come to know You, Lord Jesus Christ, as their Lord and Savior. Father, we ask these things in the wonderful and the powerful name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Simon's going to speak with us now, and just as he begins, see if you recognize any of these faces in this little video.
The greatest day of my life was when I married my best friend Andrea in front of all of our friends and family.
The greatest day of my life was the day I got my dream job.
This day in my life was when I chose to embrace the creative gifts given to me instead of comparing myself to others.
And the greatest day of my life was probably when we went to Disneyland. It was really fun.
The greatest day of my life was being born.
The greatest day of my life was, I was going to say my wedding day, which was a good day, but it was actually the day my wife and I met.
My greatest day of my life was at the birth of my two daughters.
So the greatest day of my life was getting married to my awesome husband Richard and then seeing my baby's faces for the first time.
The greatest day of my life was the day that the Street City Church went online.
The best day of my life was marrying Tom.
And the best day of my life was buying my new guitar.
Ah! So the best day of my life is when I learn about God.
The greatest day of my life was going to Fiji.
The greatest day of my life was when Tiger King came on Netflix.
The greatest day of my life was when I married my wonderful wife, Michelle.
Eat the bunny.
One of the greatest days in my life
was when I got to race a car around a racetrack and jump out of an aeroplane with a parachute on.
The greatest thing of my life was getting my cat next.
Greatest day of my life. I actually had four greatest days. They were the days I brought my babies home from the hospital when they'd been born.
The greatest day of my life was during my Gold Duke of Edinburgh tramps.
The greatest day in my life was when I saw my husband hold my son in his arms for the first time.
Good morning. How good was that, that we got to hear from people about what they consider to be their greatest day? You know, I think you can tell a lot about people by what they consider to be their greatest day. I think you just have to be careful who you tell. A couple of years ago, I got to go and see the British Lions against the All Blacks in Wellington, and I'd waited 20 years for that day. And I'd gone into the ballot to get tickets, and I'd got my jersey, and a friend had flown in from Aussie. And we queued up to get into the game. The atmosphere was amazing. And against all the odds, the Lions won. I screamed and shouted and sang so much that for the next 2 weeks, my voice just wasn't quite right. And in the midst of all of that celebration, I may have said to Jenny, "This is the greatest day of my life." It didn't go down too well. This was after our wedding day. This was after the birth of all three of our children. It was after I had met some of you. But in the heat of the moment, I decided that that was the greatest day of my life. And I realized that All Blacks in defeat in the same sentence is never going to be a great day for many of you. But please don't be offended. Don't check out right now. Just use this as a moment to see that for all of us, what we consider to be our greatest days come from very different perspectives. But I want to share with you a great day this morning that I believe can be the greatest day for all of us. And it was a Sunday morning. It begins really early as the sun is just coming up and the temperature starts to rise. I would imagine there's dew, you know, evaporating and a bit of mist. And two women very early go out for a walk into a garden. And this weekend has been devastating for them. They have lost a loved one, a friend, a teacher, one they hoped was God's Messiah, Jesus. But this morning they're going through this garden towards the tomb where he's buried. And then they meet an angel. Can you imagine the shock? Can you imagine the surprise? Can you imagine the heart rate and what would have been going on in that moment? And the cool thing is that Matthew, one of Jesus's disciples, he thought that these events were so significant as well that he wanted to record them so that we have the privilege of reading them today. And so we're going to turn to Matthew 28, verse 5, and we're going to read these words together. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He is risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he is risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you." I want you to see that the angel says a number of remarkable things to these women. First of all, he says, "He is not here." And it's really significant that Matthew records that conversation, those words being said to these women. You see, because over the previous the paragraphs that come before this in Matthew's account show that when Jesus was dying on the cross and his blood was flowing out and he'd been beaten beyond sort of all recognition, and as his life ebbed away, these women, have been standing there watching. And later that evening, as a man called Joseph had come and taken the body down off the cross and wrapped him and laid him in this tomb carved out of rock in this garden, these same women were sitting opposite the tomb watching. And so now when they hear he is not here, they know it's because he just sort of fell asleep. They know it's not there because they saw him die. And they know that it's not that there was a mix-up with the burial, because they saw that too. And so when they hear he is not here, while they don't really understand, they know that something else must have happened. And the angel tells them he is not here, he has risen. You know, the strange thing about those words, as I said, what the angel said is remarkable. Yet this word risen is not really a remarkable word at all. It's actually pretty ordinary. It's used for rising off of a chair. It's used for rising out of bed or waking up. What is remarkable about these words is that they're used here to describe Jesus, who was stone cold, dead and buried in the grave, now up, living, breathing, walking, talking. He is not here. He has risen. And then the angel goes on to say, just as he said. The angel wants us to know, Matthew wants us to know, this was no accident. This was no coincidence. In fact, Jesus was not surprised by this. All along, he had been saying, I'm going to die. And on the third day, I will be raised to life again. See, this was his mission. This was his life's purpose. You know, our world, there is so much pain and suffering. And I think deep down in all of us, there is this sense that that's not the way it should be. And God says, you're absolutely right. In this good world that he created, we, you and I, humanity, rejected his ways, rejected him, and chose to go our own way. God calls that sin. And it's the root cause of our pain and suffering, and its ultimate consequence is death. But God doesn't point the finger and say, I told you so. He doesn't stand far off. He sent his one and only son to enter our pain and suffering in the person of Jesus Christ, God's one and only son. And he lived a perfect life, but he still died, not because of his own sin, because there wasn't any, but to pay the price for our sin. But the story didn't end there. God raised him to life again, proving that sin could be forgiven and proving that death had been defeated. And the promise that comes with that is just as Christ has been raised, so we too can be raised. It means everything changes. It means that was the greatest day and has the potential to have the greatest impact on our lives. You know, in our culture, we have words that we love to talk about, words like hope and peace and love, but those words will always be limited in our vocabulary until they find their meaning in the resurrection, in the risen Lord Jesus. Take hope, for example. You know, so often when we talk about hope, you hear things like, I hope my team wins. I hope I win the lottery. I hope I meet someone. I hope my kids turn out okay. I hope I stay healthy. I hope I keep my job. I hope my business is okay. So often we use hope to describe something that is uncertain and out of our control. But because Jesus is alive, he proves that our greatest enemy has been defeated. And so because of that, it means that at my final day on earth, I can stand at that moment with hope, with this certain hope that I'm about to meet him face to face, and I'm about to be more alive than I have ever been. And if I can have hope in that moment, I can have hope in every other day because he's alive. You know, we also talk about peace, and so often peace is circumstantial as well. Peace often has to do with, do I have enough money in the bank? Do I have a roof over my head? Would the people around me just stop fighting? If they did, I can have peace. But because Jesus is alive, it proves that even death is under his control. And if that is under his control, then so is everything else. And so he is able to provide everything I need, and he's able to take me through every situation and circumstance. And so it means he's able to grant me
peace. He's able to grant me this deep inner sense of provision and security, even when the world around me is in turmoil. I can have peace because he's alive. You know, even love, a word we hear so often, is limited until we find its meaning in the resurrection. You know, the greatest expression of love is that where somebody dies for somebody else. And so I can tell you today that I know God loves you because he sent Jesus to die in your place to demonstrate to you that you are a person who is greatly loved. But the fact that he is raised takes that to another level, because he says, I love you, I am for you, but because I'm raised and will never die again, I will never leave you, I will never forsake you, nothing can ever separate me from your love, from my love. And so these great things of hope and of peace and of love and of forgiveness, these great things cost God so much, and yet because of who he is, he offers them to you as a free gift today if you would come to a place where you believe that Jesus is alive and receive these things from him in turn and follow him. I wonder where you're at with that today. I love that the angel then goes on to say, verse 6, come and see the place where he lay. You know, we notice across this scene, there's no police line, do not cross. Crime scene, don't enter. There is an invitation from the angel. Don't just take my word for it. Come and investigate. Come and see for yourself. The same invitation to come and see is available to every single one of us today. I think there's great evidence in these accounts in the Bible. Have you read them? I think there's great evidence outside of the Bible. My question is, this news is so great. Have you actually gone after investigating it for yourself? But I think there's more evidence even on top of that, because then the angel says to them, then go quickly and tell. And they did. They went and told Jesus's disciples. And when they believed, they in turn told others who told others who told others. You know, you are surrounded by people all over this city, all over our world, who believe in Jesus for themselves. And I love the fact that they are part of this great succession of people, generation after generation, century after century, who have heard this good news, believed it, and shared it. And I believe these words, peace and hope and love and forgiveness, characterize their lives. You know, I realize you might be a little skeptical about me. You don't want to take my word for it any more than you do the last person who knocked on your door and offered to save you money on your power bills. But there are people in your life, maybe a neighbor, maybe a colleague, maybe a distant relative that you know believes in Jesus. Have you talked to them? Maybe you wouldn't believe me, but maybe you would believe them. Go ask them about peace. Go ask them about hope. Go ask them about this love. I wonder how many of them would say that the day they first believed in Jesus was the greatest day of their life. I love, though, that the story, this narrative, this account doesn't even end there. The angel doesn't. God doesn't require these women to base their belief just on the absence of Jesus as they turn. In verse 9, it says, suddenly Jesus met them. Greetings, he said. They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshipped him. This was no ghost. This was no spirit. This was a physical resurrection. They clasped his feet and they got to worship him. And the way the account goes on is that Jesus appeared to many people at many times, and then they watched him ascend into heaven, and he promised that one day he would return. It means he's alive today. It means he's near to every single one of us. It means if you call out to him, he hears. If you've got questions, you can ask them. If you want to begin a conversation with him today and ask him for forgiveness and ask him to give you that hope and that peace and that love, he'll do that. It means if you search for him, he promises to be found by
you. You can reach out to him today because he's alive. You know, in a few moments, Nick and Sarah are going to lead us in a prayer where you can give your life to Jesus for the first time. Before that, we've asked one of our team to play a song for us called Because He Lives. I love this song. And you may want to listen to the words. You may want to use these moments to reflect on what you've heard in this message, in this account. You might even want to use these moments to begin a conversation with Jesus yourself. I wonder what your greatest day is. For many people, the greatest day of their lives is the day they give their life to Jesus. And here's my prayer for you, that this day is that great day for you.
God sent His Son. They called Him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior. Because He lives.
Welcome to our table. Welcome to our bubble. I wonder if today, as you've listened to Simon talking about the amazing Easter story, the message of Jesus Christ, I wonder as you've worshipped and listened to the words of that final song, whether maybe you've decided that, yeah, I do believe that Jesus Christ has died for my sin and I want a relationship with God. The wonderful thing about the Easter story is that God wants a relationship with you. It's not something you drift into. Jesus didn't just drift into the cross, and we don't just drift into a relationship with him. But it's something that we can choose right now to enter into. And I wonder if for you today, today might be that great day that Simon talked about, that day where you put your faith in Jesus Christ, the one who is alive, who rose from the grave. If you would like to put your faith in Jesus, then I'm going to lead you right now in a prayer that you can pray and just give over your life to him. The amazing thing is that when you do that, not only do you have certainty and hope and peace and the very presence of the living God with you, no matter what happens on this earth, not only that, but when you die beyond the grave, you have an eternal life with God. Your hope lives on. Because he lives, you also will live forever. So if now's your moment, if this is when you want to give your life over to Jesus Christ, or possibly if you once gave your life to Jesus, but you haven't been walking closely with him and you'd like to come back to him, then how about you join me as we pray right now? Father God, thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to the earth to carry the weight of my sin, to die for me, so that I can have a relationship with you. Father God, right now, I give my life to you. I turn away from unbelief and I put my belief, my faith in Jesus Christ, in his death on the cross and in his resurrection. Clean me from my sin. Please come into my life. I give you my life and I choose to follow you from this day forward. Thank you for the eternal life that is mine in the name of the living Son of God, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
You know, if you prayed that today, if that was an expression for your heart, we'd love to talk with you. You'll find there's a email address online at thestreet.org.nz, and we would just love for you to email us in and let us know your decision today. You'll have noticed a wonderful meal spread in front of us here, and we're here in our bubble. We've got Hattie, our daughter, and her husband Dave, and we're going to tuck into some lunch shortly. But before we do that, we're going to share communion, and you may be prepared with communion at your place as well. It's one of those things which often is done in churches, but there's no reason why you wouldn't actually do it in a home around a dining table, which is what we're doing today. And so let me read to you from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, starting at verse 23. Here's a beautiful description of communion. I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. This is the Apostle Paul teaching. And he says, the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it. Dave, wonder if you can do that for us now. And in your home, in your bubble, maybe you've got bread, you'd like to break that now and let's share it together. When he broke it, Jesus said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. You know, as we take the bread now, it reminds us that there is life, and that life is found in the name of Jesus. And so let's take the bread now. And as you do that, just think, God, you have given me life. The life I have comes from you. Let's share that together now, shall we? You know, in the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup and he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it to remember me." And I love the reality that the blood of Jesus reminds us that there is forgiveness and that we have absolute forgiveness in his name. You know, the incredible thing is that so often people think, I've got to do all these things to be acceptable to God or to whatever I think might be out there. And yet God himself came and said, I'm going to show you who I am. And Jesus walked this earth and we saw who God was. And then because he died on the cross and he was buried and he rose again, we have absolute forgiveness. It's not because of what we need to do. It's because of what Jesus has done. So let's take the drink. Let's drink it and let's remember that we have forgiveness in his name. Would you like to do that with us also? And you know, the last thought, the last verse here, verse 26 of 1 Corinthians chapter 11 says this, whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. It strikes me that that's a funny statement. How can you proclaim somebody's death until they come? If they've died, where are they coming from? And it tells us, as Simon reminded us, that Jesus Christ is not dead. He conquered death and he conquered sin and he is coming again. And that is the hope that every single one of us who follows Jesus Christ has, that no matter what may come in this world, we have absolute certainty and security in Jesus Christ. What a treasure.
Amen. Mm. Wow, thanks for joining us at our table today. It's been just wonderful having this time with you. And we're very lucky that we get to share our home together, the four of us. This is a good bubble to be in. We're going to go on and have a bit of an Easter feast and enjoy our lunch together soon. But we'll see you next week. Next week, we actually start a new sermon series, and it's in the book of Genesis, the very, very first book of the Bible. So that's super exciting to get into that book and learn what the Creator did right at the very, very beginning with this world that we live in. And so join us at 10 o'clock next week. It'll be wonderful to be together again. If you would like to make any response to today's service, or remember, if you've got any photos you'd like to send in, then do send those in to online@thestreet.org.nz. And other than that, I think that's us, isn't it?
Got a beautiful song that you're going to hear on the way out, and there's some photos that people had sent in last week. Again, just enjoy them. It's all part of our community here at The Street. So yeah. God bless you.
Have a great Easter. Don't eat too much chocolate, or do eat too much chocolate.
Yeah, we'll try. So here we go. All right, God bless.
See you. Bye.
to your name, Lord.